will be live in 5, 4, 3.
Welcome everybody here to the September 24, 2015 meeting of the Brighton Town Board. We're meeting on a Thursday night tonight. As we mentioned at the last meeting, we changed the date of this meeting out of respect for the High Holy Days, Yom Kippur, yesterday. So that's why we're here on a Thursday night. I would note that, as always, the agenda and all supporting materials for this meeting are on the table in the back of the room. I would also note, for those of you that are watching at home, either on live TV, on our Community Access TV channel, or streaming on the internet, that the agenda and all of the supporting materials for tonight's meeting were posted on our webpage yesterday. So if you want to take a look at it at home, please do so at the town's website, www.townofbrighton.org. We'll be going to the open forum in a minute, but we are going to be changing our agenda just a little bit tonight. We're going to start with a presentation to various representatives of the fire service in honor of National Fire Protection Week, which is coming up. But then we are going to adjust the agenda slightly and hold the public hearing concerning the Brickyard Trail and the removal of trees. We do have a sign language interpreter with us tonight, so we'd like to get that portion of the meeting completed as quickly as possible, and then we will go back. We will have the presentation of the budget. We will then have the open forum, and then we'll go on with the rest of the meeting. So I would just note that in case of an emergency, you'll hear the town hall emergency alarm system. If you hear that, please exit the auditorium immediately, either through the door to my right, and if you take that door, turn right, go down the stairs and out the back entrance of town hall and move away from the building. Or you can exit through either of the two exit doors in the rear of this room, straight ahead, out the front door of Town Hall, down the steps, and away from the building. Now, occasionally we may experience technical difficulties. If you're watching the live broadcast on Time Warner Cable and you have either sound or video trouble, please contact Time Warner at 756-5000. That's 756-5000. I do want to start with a pledge to the flag, and I'm going to ask Town Board Member Jason DiPanzio to lead us.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And as I indicated a moment ago, we are going to start with a proclamation recognizing National Fire Protection Week. And I'm going to ask, we have representatives here from the Brighton Fire Department, Chief Steve McAdam, from the Rochester Fire Department, Deputy Chief Thomas Zatko, and Brighton Fire Marshal Chris Roth. And if you could all come and join me at the podium, please. Mrs. Leary's cat, a cow rather, really didn't start the Chicago fire. But the Chicago fire was the impetus for declaring the first full week in October every year as National Fire Prevention Week. And I do want to read this proclamation that the town board will be presenting tonight in honor, and then I'll offer each of the opportunity to speak. Whereas the town of Brighton is committed to ensuring the safety and security of all those living or working in and visiting our community, Whereas fire is a serious public safety concern, both locally and nationally, and homes are the location where people are at greatest risk from fire. Whereas working smoke alarms continuously scan the air for smoke 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and assist individuals and families in escaping a deadly home fire and cut the risk of death in reported home fires by 50%. And whereas Brighton's first responders are dedicated to reducing the occurrence of home fires and home fire injuries through prevention and protection education. And whereas residents who have installed smoke alarms in every sleeping room, outside each separate sleeping area, and on every level of the home are much more likely to survive a fire. Whereas roughly half of all home fire deaths result from fires reported between 11 p.m. and 7 a.m. when most people are asleep. And whereas each year, the first full week in October is designated as Fire Prevention Week, which presents the perfect opportunity to better educate the public about potentially life-saving messages. And whereas the 2015 Fire Prevention Week theme, "Hear the Beep When You Sleep, Every Bedroom Needs a Working Smoke Alarm," effectively serves to remind us that a working smoke alarm in every sleeping room increases the chances of residents waking if a home fire occurs while they're asleep. Now, therefore, be it proclaimed that the Brighton Town Council does hereby recognize October 4th through 10th, 2015, as Fire Prevention Week, and supports the many public safety activities and efforts of Brighton's fire and emergency services. And we urge our residents to check their smoke alarms monthly, inspect their homes for any and all fire hazards regularly, and be sure that smoke alarms are installed in all sleeping areas on every level of their homes. This proclamation is signed this 24th day of September 2015 by myself, Brighton Town Supervisor, and the members of the Brighton Town Board. I'm going to present this to you, Chief, with our gratitude for your work.
Half the Brighton Fire Department, thank you for proclaiming and this Fire Prevention Week. We know fire prevention happens 52 weeks a year, and we highlight this 1 week. We'll kick it off with an open house on the 4th at our Station 1. And special this year, it's our 90th anniversary, so 2 o'clock we'll have some birthday cake along with cider and donuts. As we reminded people before, town board members that people that are residents know that we're very fortunate living in Brighton, how it is a really a team commitment. If you've called 911, the fire department, the police department, the ambulance work hand in hand to do fire prevention, and with the city of Rochester, one of our closest neighbors, often we'll work with them. We have a great working relationship with there. So we'll be in schools starting now until the end of November, doing fire prevention. I remind parents at home, when your son and daughter came home and say that we had a fire drill today in school, that during Fire Prevention Week is a great time to practice a fire drill in your home as well.
And of course, the Rochester Fire Department is providing professional service in West Brighton, in the West Brighton Fire Protection District area. And so I next will call Executive Deputy Chief Thomas Atko of the Rochester Fire Department to the podium. Chief?
As the supervisor mentioned, the theme this year for Fire Prevention Week is Hear the Beep Where You Sleep, and the most critical part is make sure you have working smoke detectors in all the bedrooms. Working smoke detectors everywhere, obviously, is a key, so always check your batteries, make sure they're working. But this year's theme, because it is so important, is Hear the Beep Where You Sleep. So every bedroom, every sleeping area should have a working smoke alarm. And we just want to ensure that everybody checks that. And if you don't, you could call and get one, or go to your Home Depot or Lowe's, or I'm not going to promote any one individual company, but please get them. Thank you.
Thank you, Chief. And every day, our Brighton Fire Marshal, Chris Roth, is working with businesses, working with town staff, working with these two great public safety agencies to make sure the community stays safe. Chris?
Thank you, Mr. Supervisor, council people, and distinguished guests. As I mirror the two sentiments of my colleagues, where you sleep, hear the beep. If you do not have a smoke detector that's in your home and you feel that you need one, feel free to contact my office at 784-5220, and we will be able to get a smoke detector installed in your home for you. If you're elderly or disabled or have handicap and unable to change your battery, utilize that same number and we will come out and provide free replacement for you make sure that you have an operational smoke detector within your home. And last but least, please remember that we're creeping up on that time of the year in November where we have to change our clocks, change our batteries. So again, remember when we do that on Sunday evening at 2 a.m. in the morning, for those of you that are still up, change those clocks, change those batteries. And please remember, carbon monoxide is just as important as CO, or as our fire alarm systems. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Again, I do want to remind everybody, week from Sunday, October 4th, the open house. It's a great family event, but there's plenty there for kids of all ages. So thank you all very much. As I indicated a moment ago, we are now going to deviate slightly from the agenda as printed. And we are going to go to, let me do this. I'd like to have a motion first to approve the agenda.
So moved.
Second.
Dan, please call the roll.
Councilmember Vogel?
Aye.
Councilmember DePonzio?
Aye.
Councilmember Werner?
Aye.
Supervisor Mailey?
Aye. Okay, now we're going to address, we have one public hearing tonight. That public hearing is under the town tree law. It relates to the proposed removal of four significant trees along the proposed Brickyard Trail. This is the second public hearing that we've held on this topic, and we welcome the opportunity to hear from you about this matter. There, you do have in your packets a map showing the location of these four trees. I would note that once we do formally start the public hearing, if you want your comments to be on the record, I will recognize you. Please come to the podium. If you would, please state your name and your address. Comments during the public hearing should be directed to the board and not to other members of the audience. Please be courteous. Please try to keep your comments as concise as possible. And if you have written material that you'd like to submit, please feel free to do so to our town clerk. I now declare the public hearing to be open. And I'll ask our Commissioner of Public Works, Tim Keefe, just to say a couple of words about the Brickyard Trail project and about the need for tree removal. Tim?
Thank you, Supervisor. I'd be glad to. As you may be aware, folks, this is a project that traverses property that is essentially situated across the street from the town hall, commonly known as the Farish property. And the town came into receipt of that property a few years back as part of a donation. And one of the things that has been envisioned is to have a pedestrian trail through that property from Elmwood to Westfall. The town engaged a consultant to look at the property and do an environmental assessment and come up with a plan to design the trail. As part of that, unfortunately, we have identified that there is a need to remove some trees along the limits of the project. There are four significant trees, and we do not take the tree removal lightly. The town has been a Tree City USA for a number of years. And this is one step in the town's tree ordinance that we have to follow, and it gives people an opportunity to comment upon the proposal. The Public Works Committee and the Town Tree Council have reviewed this proposal. They concur based upon what they have seen as alternatives and options and impacts that these trees should be removed to facilitate installation of the trail. And with that, Supervisor, we do have in the audience our representative Sue Steele from Bayer Associates, our consultant, as well as the town engineer, Mike Guyon, that could perhaps answer other questions if need be.
And I think it's also important to note that a lot of time and thought went into the development of the path of the trail. That was a process intended to make sure that the path of the trail did not unnecessarily encroach upon the residential neighborhoods on either side of the trail. It was also a path intended to minimize the need for tree removal. It also takes advantage of the presence of the rail bed of the former narrow gauge railroad that served that area when that area was dredged for clay back in the 19th century. And using that highland, which was approved by the DEC, which was another important step in the development of the path of the trail, enabled the town to minimize the amount of boardwalk or other encroachment into the very important wetland area, which potentially could have disturbed that wetland and, just as importantly, significantly increased the cost of the project. If these trees are removed, we will be replacing trees. And so with that, is there anyone that would like to address the board on this public hearing at this time? Yes, sir. Come on up to the podium. Please state your name and address.
Hello. Hi, my name is Oleg Brezhnev. I live on Ashley Drive, 147.
Can I ask you to spell your name, please? I'm sorry.
B-R-E-Z-H-N-E-V, as in Victor.
Thank you.
So I'm not going to ask about the who's going to use this trail, because to me it's not really, like, as I see it, not really usable, because I've been with my dog, you know, before, walking dog close to this swamp, and it's just impossible to be there because of mosquitoes and a bunch of other bugs. It's just physically impossible to be, but it's okay. In order about removal of these trees, I see on the map that it shows the trail is pretty much straight. And if this trail is for the recreational purposes, which I assume, so I heard you said that it's using the oldest railroad thing, which is, yes, will save money, but at least maybe it's possible to go like around the trees, because not too many trees in the middle anyway. I understand that it will be replaced, but it will take time to grow since those trees are already there. So maybe, like, you leave the whole path, but just make either kind of like split or like go around the trees. It will make the trail more interesting, maybe, and save the trees.
Thank you.
Cutting the trees cost money too, plus it took probably 100 years to grow for those trees. So that's my opinion.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else that would like to address the board during this public hearing? Anybody from the town board?
We reviewed this at the Public Works last committee, and these, if you look at these are sizable trees, 1 to 60 inches in diameter. And you would say, well, why would you take out such a large tree? Well, it's not the only willow tree we have in the woods there, but we did look at this, and we felt that if you don't take out these four trees, then we're going to end up taking out other trees, because this is not just a wide open plain or farmland that has no trees. So, you know, if you shift this left or right, you're going to be ending up taking out other trees as well. Now, this was reviewed by our tree council, which are neighbors, residents of Brighton, who have a interest and also an expertise when it comes to trees. So we were relying not just on our judgment and recommendations, but also use them as a ballast in terms of testing our logic as to what is the appropriate manner in which we go about, you know, selecting these trees. Tim, you want to add anything to what I just said here?
Jim, you're absolutely right from the standpoint that if we do relocate the alignment of the trail, we impact other trees. That's a given, and that was evaluated for a number of reasons. As the supervisor said, Bill mentioned that you may get into more cost, may get into more environmental sensitive areas. So the alignment was chosen very carefully, as you noted. So moving the trail doesn't lessen the impact, may even make the impact greater. I would also like to just note, too, that the last item on tonight's agenda has to deal with the saving, if you want to call it that, the treatment of a stand of ash trees on this property that the town has felt important enough to go in and treat for the emerald ash borer, which we previously had not been on our radar because we had not had the survey of all the trees. So from that standpoint, I think the town has really approached this conscientiously, as is our consultant, and I think that we have, you know, strived to not only have the best alignment with the least impact, but also gone the extra step to save some trees over on the property that may otherwise, you know, not be saved.
Thanks, Tim.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else that would like to address the board during this public hearing? Then I declare this public hearing to be closed. You do have a resolution in front of you, and I would invite a motion concerning this matter, after which we can have any further discussion.
The matter before us, I'd like to move on the resolution of the resolution that was prepared by the attorney to the town for the removal of these four trees along the Brickyard Trail.
Can I have a second?
Second.
Discussion. Hearing none, Dan, please call the roll.
Councilmember Vogel?
Aye.
Councilmember DePonzio?
Aye.
Councilmember Werner?
Aye.
Supervisor Maley?
I appreciate your coming tonight. This is, a very exciting project, and I would encourage those of you that haven't done so. I know some people may walk in the area, but the website, brightontrail.org, I think the photo that you'll see when you open the page shows what a striking area this is. And opening it up, I have no doubt that there are bugs in there, particularly at certain times of year, but it's also a public entree to a wetland and a historic piece of property. And I do think that our landscape consultant, I want to really thank Bayer Associates for the great work that they've done, not only with coming up with this path, but also with the interpretive signage and other elements of the project that you will see at both trailheads. So I look forward to proceeding with this project. I look forward to seeing people from the community using this trail to bike and to walk, to get to the Buckland Park, and to see one of the most beautiful areas in town. And for that reason, and knowing that we are saving those ash trees, we will be planting trees, I vote aye. So the matter has been approved. I want to thank you all again. We will now go back in the agenda to the town operating and capital improvement budget for 2016. Very quickly, and our budget director, Andrew Robinson, will be making a presentation on the budget. But I do want to just address a couple of things. First, from a process perspective, this is a budget that has been developed, as it always is, with public participation throughout the process, first with the development of a capital improvement plan, and now a three-year capital improvement plan, with input from our Sustainability Oversight Committee and our Budget Review Task Force. We conducted public hearings, public meetings on that capital improvement plan, and that plan has been incorporated in this budget. From here, we will be holding two public hearings at our next two meetings in October. Those meetings will be held on October 14th and 28th. We will be voting on, I anticipate, on this budget on October 28th. And that's important for two reasons. One, State law requires that we hold one public hearing. Frankly, we don't think that's enough. We want to make sure the public sees this budget, which you will tonight, has time to consider it, and come back to us with any suggested changes. Two, we think it's important that we finish this process, which is one of the most important things that we do as a town board, before the election process every year. Not every government does that, but you will have these two public hearings, and you will have a budget approved by this town board, I anticipate, prior to the elections in November. So without any, just a couple of other things too. Well, I'm gonna let Andrew present the budget. I may have a couple things to say afterwards. Again, we won't be taking comment tonight, but take a look at this. It will be on our webpage, and I invite you all to come back on October 14th or 28th for your comments. We're gonna go back in the back of the room so we can see the presentation as well.
Well, I'm glad to see so many people came out just for this tonight. Last year, there was about two people in this room, so we're making progress here. I'd just like to point out, it's refreshing to me to see the amount of involvement that goes into the budget. You know, it's not just a one-man job. Town board is very in-depth involved. Some committees like the Budgetary Task Force Committee and the Sustainability Oversight Committee have a lot of input. The departments and staff, it's just a collaborative process. So this is a year-long process, and you know, we'll definitely look for more input. I think Bill had mentioned, but you can find the budget several ways. It's in hard copy. You can go to the library and they have a copy of it. You can go to the town clerk's office and thumb through a copy of it. Probably the easiest way is that it's online. If you go to our town website, right on the left-hand side of the page, the second option down is called annual budget documents, and you can look at this year's budget, a lot of detail. You can look at this presentation I'm presenting tonight. So please take an opportunity to be involved. If you have questions, come back on the public hearings and tell the town board. I'd just like to real quick point out, I do this every year, sometimes I think people don't quite grasp all the services that the town is providing with the tax dollars that the town levies. So just a few quick highlights. If you live in Brighton, you have a police force, 40 officers. You can see last year they responded to 25,000 response calls. So I mean, that's quite a bit of work. The town has a big infrastructure. The town's almost fully built out. A lot of it is old. So it's a lot to maintain. Just one little statistic that kind of stood out to me is, you can see here on the bottom section, town crews collected about 65,000 yards of brush and leaves. So I have a little pickup that takes about 1 yard, so it'd be like 65,000 pickup loads that the town collected last year. So just a little tidbit of how much work the town's doing. The library is supported by town taxes, certainly a key part of the community. One statistic I liked was that over 700,000 materials were checked out last year. The town provides lots of parkland, and we're just talking about a trail, year-round recreation programs. You can see near the bottom here that the town had over 600 sessions of recreation programs last year. And then maybe things you don't always think about, but things that, you know, help the public safety, like fire codes, the fire marshal, the work he does, the work that our public works department does, reviewing building projects and ensuring things are built up to code. You know, if you ever want a marriage license or a passport, you need to come to the town clerk. Lots of things that the town provides. So now to get a little bit of the numbers. Back in 2011, the state passed a law called the tax cap law. A lot of people think that it's a 2% increase, but it's not just that. There's a whole formula, and I won't get into it.
But I'll just point out, every year over the past 5 years, the town has stayed within the tax cap. We have never exceeded it. For 2016, because inflation is so low, our tax cap allowable increase is only 0.7%. The town has come in slightly beneath that, 0.67% increase. Last year, the state also created an addition to the tax cap called the tax freeze program. Without getting into the specifics, basically if the town stays within the tax cap, and then also created a plan to save 1% of savings over a 3-year period, residents would get a rebate check from the state for any increase in town taxes. This applies to all levels of government. So if the school district or the county or any level of government stayed within the cap, that would be included in the rebate that you receive. So last year, 15 was the first year, and the town stayed under the tax cap. So I don't know if checks have been sent out yet, but this fall, the first round of checks should be sent out to residents. And it's going to be a combined check for all the taxing jurisdictions you're part of, so fire districts or the town or county schools, it's all going to be combined. But the town's, any increase in town taxes is going to be refunded. And the same thing for 16, assuming that this budget is passed under the tax cap, which is proposed, and we have submitted a plan, an efficiency plan, there would be another rebate check that would be mailed in the fall of 16 to residents. Now to get into a little bit about the budget numbers for this year, this slide is just a quick overview about what we're planning on spending and how we plan to fund the spending. So you can see the total budget is about $29 million between all the different funds, the town funds and the special districts. Special districts include things like sidewalk snow removal, sidewalk maintenance, refuse districts, sewer districts, lots of different things, and that can vary across the town depending on which neighborhood you live in. That $29 million in spending is going to be offset by about $8.9 million in non-property tax revenues. We're planning on using about $1.9 million in fund balances and reserves, which basically means savings the town has to fund the budget, with the remainder, about $18 million, coming through taxes. So you can see year over year here at the bottom, it's about spending is decreasing by about $100,000. Revenue is about exactly offset, decreasing by about $100,000. And we're also decreasing the amount that we're using from savings to balance the budget by about $124,000. So the net result is an increase of $122,000, or that 0.67% increase that I talked about a minute ago. On the revenue side, just a little bit about what's changing this year. The main increase is we have a large pilot payment, which is a payment in lieu of taxes from the Brickstone Senior Housing Project that was recently built. Sales tax and mortgage tax, we're expecting very slight increases. The main revenue decrease was that we received a couple grants last year for some work on Highland Avenue and for a comprehensive plan. Those are one-year projects, so our grant funding is decreasing. Just wanted to talk real quick about the two biggest non-property tax revenues we have, our mortgage tax and our sales tax. Without getting too detailed, I just wanted to show you the red line here is actual, what happened to mortgage tax revenue, and the green line is what we budgeted. So I just wanted to point out, it's just hard to budget. You can see back in 2001, we were about $700,000-$800,000. And then 2 years, it almost doubled up to about $1.5 million. And then just as quickly, it went almost all the way back down. And since then, it's kind of been all over the place. So this is a really hard revenue to budget. It depends on the housing market, how many homes are sold, depends on what commercial properties are sold. The town's tried to take a conservative approach. We budgeted a little high in 2014, and so we've tried to kind of knock that back down to a more historical level for last year and this coming year. Sales tax is a little easier to budget for. The only times when it's decreased in the past 20 years has been during recession, so I don't have it on the slide here, but after 9/11 there was a decrease in sales tax, and then obviously with the housing crisis there was a large decrease. But over the past 10 or 15 years we've had about a 6% increase if you look on average. We are trying to be more conservative than that, and we've only budgeted a 3.5% increase on actuals for this year and next year. This is a one-page overview of our spending, just a couple of the main things that are affecting this year. You can see in our wages, that's personal service. Elected officials are not taking any increase. Our non-represented employees have a 2% increase in wages. And our three unions are per their union contracts. That's about a total 2% increase. Equipment funding is down about 10%. Our supplies funding is down about 1%. I'll just point out that for several years we've asked departments to cut their kind of discretionary supplies and contractual spending, and they've done that. This year we asked them to keep supplies flat, and they did comply with that. Most of the savings is resulting from fuel savings because fuel costs are so down. We're also benefiting this year from lower utility costs, just because energy markets out there are low. We do have a somewhat significant amount of new debt. For the past couple years, we've been borrowing around about $1 million a year. But that's also offset by principal we're paying in. So just this year, for a little example, we plan on borrowing about $832,000 for some equipment. But we're going to be paying off slightly more than that in principal, so our net indebtedness is not really increasing. I think the town board has taken a very conservative approach to the amount of debt that the town has. And then probably the biggest positive change is in our two big employee benefit lines. Medical costs are going to be down by about 6.5%, and this is a result of that the town has joined in a consortium of local governments in the area to pool risk for health insurance, and that's resulting in some savings. And also, we're benefiting from a rate decrease from our state-mandated employer pension. I just want to point out, even though this is going down, it's just helpful to recognize where we've been, and we have been at very large increases over the past several years. So finally, to get some relief in these areas is pretty critical for our budget, and that's what's allowed us to stay within the tax cap this year. And lastly, just a few things so you can see, it's not all cutting. The town is funding quite a bit of capital spending. We did a very prolonged several-month process, a capital improvement plan, where we developed a three-year plan of everything the town needs, and we took a real hard look at everything about what's critical, what's not critical. And the town board has decided to fund for the highway and public works about $2.7 million. The big items here are a plow truck. There's going to be a new pilot leaf vacuum system. About $1.5 million for all our roadway programs. A lot of that this year is the improvements on Monroe Avenue that are ongoing. The town is going to be purchasing three police cars as well as body cameras and data storage for police officers. Resurfacing some tennis courts at Meridian Center. And in the library, replacing an HVAC unit and furniture. And the town board also approved over $1 million in capital funding for our special districts. The majority of that is in the sewer district. As I talked about before, infrastructure. Sewer is one where we have a lot of infrastructure, but we don't see it. A lot of it is over 100 years old. So it's critical that we take this in sizable chunks and replace things. A lot of this money this year is for a new flusher truck. So in the future, if anybody has any problems with the sewer, they can rest assured we have a new flusher truck to take care of it. We're going to be replacing 15,000 square feet of sidewalk, as well as contributing to our ambulance reserve to purchase new ambulances in the future. So that's the end of the presentation. Just as I said before, feel free to look online, look at the budget. If you have questions, come to the next public hearing and ask the board about it. Thank you.
Well, while we're waiting for Councilman Werner, I do want to thank you, Andrew Robinson, our budget officer. You really do yeoman's duty every year, working with all of the departments, the two volunteer organizations, the town board, and myself. And I appreciate the work that you and Finance Director Suzanne Saso do each year in putting this budget together. We do pride ourselves in continuing to budget in a conservative manner, one that complies with the tax cap, and yet one that also recognizes that as much of an interest as we all have in fiscal responsibility, we also recognize that our residents, and we are among you, do look to get value added from town services. And I want to highlight a couple of new items. Andrew mentioned them, but I think it's important to note. One is that we are going to be adding funding for code enforcement this year. We are very much aware and continue to focus on issues that relate to property maintenance and the general condition of the community. We know what a priority that is, and so we have added new funding in this budget to address that. It also will address, unfortunately, it's a term you've heard a lot, but it's a term that unfortunately is very applicable, and that is the unfunded state mandate. And part of what we're going to be doing, these are important projects. In fact, there's a new state initiative relating to carbon monoxide, appropriate for this week, but one that is going to require significant inspection services from town officials. And unfortunately, there is no funding from the state to support those new inspection obligations that we have. So, but really the lion's share of what we've committed to additional code enforcement is to continue to address property maintenance issues in the town, and that's something we're going to be looking at very closely going forward. We talked about our Sustainability Oversight Committee, and one of the recommendations they've made, and one of the things we've heard from the community loud and clear, is how important our leaf pickup services are. As Andrew noted, a lot of our revenues fell sharply in the 2009 time period during the financial crisis. And back at that point, the previous town board made some tough decisions. One of them was cutting out overtime for leaf removal. In the current budget, in the budget that is in effect for 2015, we restored much of that overtime. So I'm hopeful that because you're going to see our crews out on a lot more Saturdays this year, particularly during the heaviest November season, to try to get those leaves picked up before the snow flies. Hopefully the snow will cooperate this year. But I anticipate you're going to see the difference in your front lawns as those leaves get picked up. But from a desire to continue to improve our efficiency and a desire to do so in the most sustainable way possible, we've also budgeted for the purchase of a leaf vacuum system. That's a system that was studied by a consultant and was recommended by our Sustainability Oversight Committee. So that purchase is in our budget. And finally, a new initiative that was also mentioned in Andrew's budget presentation are police body cameras. I don't have to tell you, we've all watched the news. But our police department, which is as professional a police department as you will find anywhere under the leadership of Chief Henderson, who was also the head this year of the Law Enforcement Council in Monroe County. We've been working hard. We've received a grant from Senator Robach to support some body camera purchase. But we also know that just like a razor needs to keep getting blades, the proverbial blade when it comes to body camera use is digital storage. And so we will be anticipating, as we develop a final policy for use of body cameras, using funding to purchase those cameras, but also the additional funding that's in the budget to begin to fund the ongoing cost of data storage for those cameras. So those are just some of the new programs that are in the budget. Again, I'm proud that we have kept the budget again this coming year. It will be the fifth year, and the fifth year we've been below the tax cap. I'm also very pleased, as Andrew pointed out, that we are actually paying off more town debt than we're incurring. One of the recommendations that I concurred with by the Budget Review Task Force is to issue short-term debt in this very low interest rate environment, and we've done that to enable ourselves to maintain our infrastructure. Our debt levels are half or less than half of what the communities we often think of as our peers, Pittsford, Penfield, Parrington. That's part of the reason that our bond rating from Moody's is AA2, a very high blue chip rating. But even with that, we will be reducing the net amount of outstanding indebtedness of the town this year. We think that is part of fiscal prudency. So with that, again, I will invite everybody to our two budget hearings on October 14th and October 28th, just as we welcomed the input from our volunteer groups, the Budget Review Task Force, and the Sustainability Oversight Committee. We welcome input from all of you, our residents, as we hold these public hearings. Now, we are going to go to the open forum portion of the meeting. Thank you all for waiting as we went through these important items. As always, the open forum is an opportunity to for anyone to discuss items, whether or not they're on the agenda. You can do so by coming up to the podium here. If you do, I would ask you again to state your name and your address for the record, if you would, please. Please direct your comments to the board and not to other members of the audience. If you have written materials that you would like to be included in the record of the meeting, we welcome that and would ask that you bring them to the town clerk. If you're at home or somewhere else and watching the meeting on your computer or on your TV, and you'd like to participate in the open forum, you can. Please call in 303-3060. That's 303-3060 is our open forum call-in line. Someone will take your question or comment and relay that to the board. If you're deaf or if you're hearing impaired, you can also participate in our open forum by calling our TDD line. That number is 784-5205. Again, TDD 784-5205. We look forward to hearing from you with any questions or comments you may have about any matter. And again, that's whether or not it appears on our agenda tonight. So is there anyone that would like to address the board during the open forum? Yes, sir.
Good evening, Supervisor Maley, members of the town board. My name is Robert Brenner, an attorney with the law firm Nixon Peabody, 1300 Clinton Square, Rochester, here this evening on behalf of Clover Allens Creek Neighborhood Association. As you might expect, my comments this evening relate to the proposed Palazzo project on Monroe Avenue. Recognizing the scope of the comments this evening and the role of the privilege of the floor will be brief, and I'd just like to address two comments that we have with respect to the final proposed scope that was released within the past 24 to 36 hours and posted on the town's website. The first issue relates to density. As was discussed at the public hearing on September 9th, and as was alluded to in the written correspondence we submitted to this town board on behalf of the association, we'd again like to emphasize that the town should limit the developer to the density and other limits required in the town code, and we'd like that to be evaluated in detail during the seeker process and the environmental impact statement process. To that end, we'd ask that you be sure before you take action on the scope this evening that the scope adequately addresses the alternatives that were alluded to in the presentation on the 9th. With respect to the alternatives we'd like you to consider, I'd relate back to what was dubbed Interest 1 and Interest 2. Interest 1 being that we'd ask you to take a hard look at alternatives which preserve the buffer between the proposed project and the residential area, and the second interest being you taking a hard look at alternatives which allow the project to be a successful project without unnecessarily dumping traffic into the adjacent residential areas. With respect to traffic, that brings me to the second point I wanted to discuss. In the draft scope that was submitted by the developer's engineer, Kostich Engineering, there's a comment in there, and I'd like to quote it for purposes of the meeting minutes. It says, quote, "The traffic impact analysis was completed." We find that troubling and a bit puzzling based on the comments that were suggested at the last public hearing with respect to some of the traffic issues that members of the community alluded to. What Stantec, the town's consultant, has done in the proposed final scope is they simply have added bullets below the Kostich narrative that was proposed by the developer. The Kostich narrative, again, states that the traffic impact analysis was completed. The Stantec proposed final scope also uses that same language, and just below it puts bullet points of issues that should be considered. We find that counterintuitive. How could the traffic impact analysis be completed, but there still be open issues that need to be considered? We'd ask the town to revise this section of the scope accordingly before it takes any action on the final scope. And we'd recommend that you take a more holistic approach to the traffic issues presented by this project. So again, just wanted to emphasize those two issues for you this evening. And again, we'd ask that you consider these issues carefully as you discuss the scope this evening and make any necessary revisions in connection with these two comments before you take action. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I ask you, I don't know whether you have the hard copy of the scope that the board will be considering.
I do.
I understand your concern. Frankly, I share it. If that language is still in the scope about the traffic study being complete, can you identify what page that is on?
Yes, I believe it is on page 7 of the scope.
Transportation is on 13.
Well, there's a couple places, Chris, where transportation is noted.
So if you look at, I believe it's section 5D.
Yep.
Transportation, if you look at the second full paragraph, second sentence, it says a traffic impact analysis has been completed.
Thank you. Well, okay.
Thank you.
Is that the only spot?
I believe, yes, that's the most significant spot. So what we'd ask the town to do is to have this section redrafted to indicate that the traffic analysis has not been completed and to perhaps redraft the narrative in these paragraphs here to incorporate what has been added as bullet points on page 8 with respect to the comments that were raised at the public hearing on the 9th.
Not to be argumentative, but it seems like it already says that. I think it's entirely accurate. Yeah, I just want to understand what revisions. It says that a traffic analysis has been completed, and then it goes on to say the following items shall also be addressed, and then those bullet points. And so I know what your concern is. I think I know what the intent of the town board is here, is to make sure that all of these issues are addressed.
And that's exactly the question we're asking. I think
right. And let me make a language suggestion. Because that was my first thought, Ken, as I looked at that completed, but I'm going to suggest that we use a different word. I'm going to suggest that we use the word prepared.
a traffic impact analysis has been
prepared.
Submitted.
I'm going to suggest prepared. Yeah.
And perhaps shall be reviewed, revised, and updated in accordance with the comments, you know, set forth below in connection with the bullet points.
Well,
I just think these bullet points need to be considered in whatever the final traffic study is.
And I think we agree.
Okay.
We do say that. The core study area shall be defined by the following intersections. I mean, we will be looking at those intersections. It is certainly the intent, obviously, and you're right, it does come through here that there will be significantly more traffic study than the initial study that was prepared and submitted.
So I'm going to suggest two revisions, actually. One is the one that you indicated, Supervisor, changing the word completed to prepared. The second change could be prior to the bullet list of issues, where it says the following items shall also be addressed in the traffic study. We could now change that to the following items shall also be addressed in a further traffic study. Would that make sense to you?
Yeah. And
I think that accomplishes what we're looking to do. We want to make sure that those issues are further addressed. We're not going to just rely on the traffic study that was already prepared. I think that's...
Okay, appreciate you clarifying.
Yeah.
The other point, if I may, I just wanted to make that, as we alluded to at the public hearing, I think there could be a benefit to the town, having the town's traffic engineer work with the developer's traffic engineer as well as the association's traffic engineer. I think there could be some synergy between those three, and we would just ask that an opportunity for that to occur be given to the association's traffic engineer.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else that would like to address the board? Yes, sir.
Good evening, all. My name is David Grant, and I reside at 10 Schoolhouse Lane. Got a couple of comments to make here tonight. Number one, the residents are asking the town that they do not provide any special deals for this proposed project. Just enforce our existing zoning limits. That's it. Just enforce the zoning code limits. That is all we ask. No special deals. There is a reason why we have those limits. Enforce them. If not here, in the worst traffic corridor in Monroe County, and with the damage a supersized project does to an adjacent residential neighborhoods, then when would they ever matter? What we've asked for is very reasonable. Downsize the project to whatever the code allows, or even less than that, to just whatever will protect our residential buffer and keep this commercial traffic on Monroe Ave where it belongs. And we cannot get either the developer for over 6 months to respond, and we have heard nothing back from the town either that it has heard us. We have tried to do this right, to try to find solutions, but instead all we've gotten back is silence. Waiting until the end of the process to get feedback is not acceptable. The board should be able to say now where this project is going. And then a second point here. This is one of the worst traffic areas in the county. This is a terrible place to ignore the normal zoning limits that have some kind of special deal. Not here. No special deals for this developer. Just apply under normal zoning with the normal zoning limits, just like everyone else. We have tried to engage this developer since April and have been rebuffed. We've tried to do everything right to find solutions. No one will respond. A grocery store of 250% greater than what the code allows is too much. A plaza at 150% greater is also too much. Enforce our zoning limits. We don't know what else to say. We've tried, and it does not seem like anyone is listening. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Grant.
Bill, I'd like to respond.
I want to wait. This is the open forum, and I do want to give our
yes,
our
right.
residents Thank who you. Are here to speak to us the opportunity to speak. So I will ask, is there anyone else that would like to? Come on up. Yeah.
Thanks for having us, Alice, tonight. My name is Matt Duell. I reside at 59 Shoreham Drive. I just had a quick statement to read, and just echoes many of Mr. Grant's statements. Please don't allow a special treatment at this location, which will damage the residential neighborhoods adjacent to it and worsen already terrible traffic conditions. Please don't ignore the zoning limits or feel forced to participate in the incentive zoning process. Please engage us in real dialogue regarding our concerns and uphold those zoning limits, which are there to protect us, and listen to the solutions and compromises that we've proposed. Thank you.
Thank you. Would you like to submit, if that's a written statement, if you'd like to submit it to the clerk? Okay, no problem. Is there anyone else that would like to address? Yes, sir, come on up.
Good evening. Ben Wurzinger, 104 Shoreham Drive. You guys know, the community is frustrated. I said this last time, 2 weeks ago when we were in front of you. In April, we've raised our concerns with the developer, and the developers ignored the community and refused to engage. Those are the facts. On August 19th, the community submitted to the town and to the developer a comprehensive review with a traffic study and a good faith attempt to find solutions. We tried to do things right, to find solutions to engage. We relayed our concerns in a meeting to the supervisor and in communications with the developer's attorney, and yet to date, the developer has refused to engage. He just presses ahead and indicates that this is a done deal. Similarly, the town to date has not substantially responded to our input at all. Each day, the project gets more solidified. We need to start hearing what concerns the town board has about the project rather than vague promises of scrutiny somewhere down the road. So we're asking for that engagement now. The developer has no right to the current process. It's voluntary by the town. Why is the town doing it? Or hasn't it committed yet? Are questions that I have. If it hasn't, we'd like to know so that we can at least feel like our efforts are futile and we're not wasting our time. So the board could certainly say now that it will not allow this project, that one, that uses on Allen's Creek and Clover Streets as thoroughfares for the project cannot be done. It will also, number two, not allow the developer to penetrate the boundary line and cut down any of the trees that buffer the residential and commercial district. And then number three, it will not allow the developer to adversely affect Monroe Avenue traffic. Those should be easy things for the board to take a stand on now, regardless of how the project is finally configured. So we're asking that you make that commitment now. We need you all to respond to us. We've tried very hard, as I mentioned, in good faith, with reasonable ideas and sound data, and we continue to get nothing back. I just saw I'm not a lawyer, but I just read a draft of the environmental impact scope. And it primarily discusses how to justify the supersized project, if you look at the entire outline. It assumes that the Clover and Allen's Creek access points can be considered part of the project, which is directly opposed to what we're asking. With great disappointment, the alternatives, which we've spent a ton of time and effort to get the board to focus on, are buried at the end, almost as an afterthought before the appendices. And that tells me where the priority is. This should be the focus of the review, not an afterthought, not a footnote before the appendix. I note the alternative sections does not specifically require that the alternatives be analyzed to try to achieve the interest of number one, number two that we discussed at the last meeting in depth. Until this is fixed, we ask you to postpone the vote or simply vote no. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Wurzinger. Is there anyone else that would like to address the board? Yes, sir.
Good evening, I'm Andrew Elder. I live on 94 Shoreham Drive. I've got a few comments to make on Palazzo Plaza. We don't believe there's any right for the developer to proceed with a supersized incentive deal. We believe it is evident that he would not have gone this far down the road unless he thought he'd at least been given some sort of soft green light from the town that this was okay. Otherwise, he would have applied for traditional zoning. So the town board can do something right now, well, certainly by the next meeting. The community would like to hear from the town board that zoning density limits will apply and the developer should apply under traditional zoning within those limits. Stop this supersized incentive zoning deal. Restart it under traditional zoning laws, under traditional zoning standards. The current incentive process is a voluntary process and should only be used when there is a mostly non-controversial project that will be a win-win for everyone. This is not the case here, and it is wrong to do it. Don't sacrifice all these important community interests for the special benefit of a private developer. Every day we go down this voluntary special deal process, it is a statement by the town that it does not recognize or acknowledge the community's concerns. So let's change that. Let's hear from the board tonight, or by the next meeting. Let's hear that our zoning limits mean something, that the community outpouring you saw at the last meeting means something, and that no one should get a special deal when it creates this much potential for damage. If ever there was a time for discipline in applying the time-tested zoning standards instead of a special deal for the developer, it is now. So please, let's hear from the board.
Thank you. Is there anyone else that would like to address the board? Mr. Gillette?
Tom Gillette, 105 Pickwick Drive. Many of my neighbors stole some of my thunder, but there's a little bit left. I was very heartened to hear your comments in introducing the budget, that the goal was to deal with the budget prior to the election, kind of so that the community would have a sense of where the money was going and what we were in for and when we cast our ballots. I'd like to transfer that to this project so that before the election, our community, our neighborhood, has a sense that the supervisor and board have heard us and that our extensive preparations of alternatives have made sense, have been considered, and that we can have a project here, a proper redevelopment of this parcel, hopefully within the zoning code limits. And our preference, of course, would be following the regular zoning code process rather than incentive zoning. But if you choose to go in a different direction, addressing the two major concerns that were restated again tonight and have been submitted in great detail, along with many additional solutions to different aspects of the original proposal, I think that would be good for the community and acceptable to the neighborhood. It is concerning to us that the developer has built an illegal quarter-acre, half-acre parking area for his use on residential property in violation of the zoning code, and the town hasn't felt the need to enforce this code, and in fact is considering a special deal to waive a whole array of zoning restrictions for this bigger project. Over the years, the developer has casually and unlawfully, I could say misappropriated, but I'll say obliterated, the community's pedestrian trail that runs along this property, and its use has been for vehicle access to the plaza. Again, in violation of the zoning laws and the community's property interests and property rights. Every day going down that paved road towards Allen's Creek, there are cars and trucks and pizza delivery vehicles at a good rate of speed. very dangerous for pedestrians, bicyclists, and as the days get shorter and it's darker, the danger for them increases. We'd like the town to protect the community's rights to this area, and we would much appreciate some feedback or response from the town board that, yes, what's already happened is a violation and it won't be tolerated, and even better, that we have little interest in this whole scale removal of the zoning restrictions that are in place for this development. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Gillette. Did you have any written comments you wanted to? No problem. Thank you. Is there anyone is there anyone else that would like to address the board in the open forum on this or any other matter? Mr. Danielli?
My name is Danny Danielli. I represent the developer and the developer's family, with my father Mario, my brother Anthony. I just wanted to briefly have a moment to explain a little bit of our side. We haven't really spoken too much on our side, as it's really not our time yet, but I know there's some contention in the air, and I want to make sure that there is some evens space on both sides. The one thing I want to make very clear is that it's a bit disheartening. I hear often that the developer has refused to engage with the residents and communication therein. We held an open meeting at our own facility a few months ago to explain the project to everyone. It was an open meeting. We attended a local neighborhood meeting that was open to the neighborhood. I'm assuming we were part of that. We explained some of our project to that, answered a tremendous amount of questions. At some point, I think we were kicked out of the meeting because I don't think they wanted to hear as much as we were telling them or whatever it may be. But nevertheless, we appreciate the time that we did have to explain what we were doing. And on the other aspect, we have been in constant communication with the organization's legal counsel from Nixon Peabody. Our attorneys have been speaking with their attorneys. We actually had a meeting scheduled a few weeks ago. And we agreed to go to that meeting for some reason. I don't know why, but Nixon Peabody wasn't ready for the meeting, so that never happened. But we were, I guess you could say, able, willing, and ready. The one thing that I want to make clear is that our offices are at Mario's. Myself, my brother, my father, we're there every day, even on the weekends. If anyone has any questions, we've answered them throughout the past 8 months. People just coming and asking questions. Sometimes we show them in the office and we show them details. I don't know how else we could be more open. We're trying to follow a procedure now that I believe every resident in the town of Brighton has the legal right to do. We appreciate the time and effort the town has put forth. We intend to follow that process and follow those laws. As far as alternatives go, the whole process that we're doing with this EIS is going to have a tremendous amount of alternatives, a tremendous amount of detail on those alternatives that I believe everyone will be able to see and understand. And two last things is regarding the trail in the back. One of the things that I think will come out in this study is there are two or three easements overlapping on that trail area behind all of those properties. Most of those properties are not owned by us, but there's a pedestrian trail over an access driving easement where traffic's allowed to go. And right now they all overlap and it's very unsafe. One of our proposals is to recreate those easements, separate them so that the traffic is in one spot and we'll be able to move in one direction the trail so that it becomes a safe aspect. Unfortunately, I don't know if everyone understands some of those details. This package that we'll be submitting shortly will have a tremendous amount of data. Hopefully that'll clear everything up. But I appreciate the time that the town and the board has given us on this project, and I thank you. And anyone has any questions, we're probably going back to the office tonight. You're more than welcome to join us. And then we'll also be in the office tomorrow morning around 7:30. Thank you.
Is there anyone else that would like to address the board, Mr. Bergdorf?
Thank you. Good evening. I hadn't planned on speaking, but I just want to clarify some of those comments by Mr. Danielli. When the neighborhood says that there's no engagement, Yes, there was a meeting, two meetings actually, that the Daniellis held, and the community was told what the project was going to be. We're not counting that. Subsequent to that, and actually during those meetings, the neighbors said, this is what they want to see. Basically, they raised interest one, interest two. There's been no engagement on those issues. That's the point. Yes, there were meetings early on. We were told what the project was going to be, but there's been no engagement or any addressing of those issues. That's what we mean by not engaged. With respect to a meeting, we did not cancel any meetings with the developer. We proposed a meeting with the developer. The developer sent their attorney, Mr. Goldman, about a month ago. We met with Mr. Goldman. We reiterated everything that was in that package of August, I believe it's 19, and have heard nothing back. So that's what the community is talking about when they say not engaging. I want to address one other issue that was raised, I guess two, because Mr. Daniele raised it. He said that they're exercising their legal right here. They certainly have a legal right to apply for incentive zoning, but they have no legal right to incentive zoning. So I just want to make that clear. That's for this board to decide. It's entirely discretionary. And the last thing about these overlapping easements, we've just completed our survey. We've completed our title review, and we are going to supply that to the town. In fact, I called Mr. Boehner today to set up a time to do that. We will leave those materials. This is not an overlapping of interests. This is an overburdening of the pedestrian easement. The pedestrian easement is there. It's prior in time. It primes the Daniele's interest. And as they must stay off that pedestrian easement and more than 5 feet from the RG&E poles. And once that happens, we don't know where they would go. So this idea that we're going to fix the trail and we're going to move it somewhere, the only thing we can see is you'd be tearing down that buffer because they've said they're going to move it east. There is no room to move it east. Poles are in the way, and then there's the buffer. So we don't know what they're proposing. So hopefully through the secret process, we're going to find out what that is. But the notion that there's an overlapping, that's not true, and we're prepared to show that with what we're going to submit to the town with respect to survey and title. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Bergdorf. Is there anyone else that would like to address the board? Yes, sir. Come on up.
I'm Harris Honickman. My residence is on 320 Troy Road. And I'm not directly affected by this project, at least the traffic that it will produce won't go near my property. But I am concerned about the other residents. I don't know these people, but they are my neighbors. My principal concern is, from what I heard from them, is that they're not being listened to. And by not listened to, not just by the project developer, but by the town board. That's really my concern. The day may come when I have a similar concern, and I want to be sure that I'm listened to. And I would hope that someone would step forward to speak on my behalf. So I'm hoping that there will be a response by the board to these citizens, and that the response will be public and forthcoming, and will give detailed methods that will respond to their concerns. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else that would like to address the board in open forum? I do want to address that point, and I was actually hoping that Mr. Bergdorf might do so because we had discussed it before the meeting. But I will, because it is important that first that everybody understands the process, and two, understands the role of the town and what we have done to date in that process. But before I say anything else, I want it to be very clear. There are no decisions that have been made by this town board to approve or disapprove the project. We appreciate that we've gotten a lot of input from people. It's good input, and I want to thank the public for their input. I appreciate the input that we've gotten from our staff consultant, from my colleagues on the board, and my colleagues on the board generated that interest, that input, from listening to all of you. It's very important. I do want to note that in this process, in this scoping process, the town having the open process that we've had is not something that's required by SEAKER. We felt it was so important, and I think events have proven that's correct, that we get formal input through a public hearing process from the board. And in fact, we felt it was so important that we told the developer, when the developer had asked that we do this in that the public hearing be held at our last meeting in August, which would enable us to have a final scope timely under the seeker guidelines, that frankly we didn't think that was an acceptable sequence of events because a lot of people are on vacation at the end of August. We wanted that meeting to be held in September, and it was, and you proved us right because you turned out, and that's what we hoped would happen. The developer, to their credit, agreed to that and gave us two extra days. There's a 60-day window within which we had the legal obligation to take action on a scope. And the developer did grant us two extra days to do that. It is in the development of that scope, which has changed dramatically from the scope that was initially presented to the town board, that you have begun to hear the town recognize the issues that you have presented. Council, in its presentation, made clear that it was important to consider a number of alternatives, including a number of alternatives that would be based on incentive zoning. That is something, at least for me, that I also agree is important to hear so that we can hear all of the potential alternatives with respect to this project. One of those alternatives, by the way, as is required by seeker, is that no action be taken, and that is an option that will be considered as we go through this seeker process. I do appreciate the work that the Nixon office has put in terms of addressing zoning and title issues with respect to Allen's Creek Road. They had hoped to have a meeting with our town staff before this. They did have to ask that meeting be put off because, frankly, it was taking them longer to delve through all the data that they were reviewing. I believe they have presented the town with some of that information tonight. I don't know, Mr. Bergdorf, if it's your intent to, obviously this is not a public hearing, whether you want it to be part of the record of this meeting or simply something you'll be reviewing in that rescheduled meeting, and either way is fine. But I want it to be clear that the town has and will continue to engage your attorney, for those of you that are part of the neighborhood group from the Nixon office, but that we will be publicly addressing issues in this detailed scope. And I also want to say one other thing. I did hear the developer indicate that he was going to submit or that the organization was going to be submitting shortly their environmental impact statement. And I want to encourage the developer to take the time necessary to go through all of the changes, all of the information that we are seeking in the scope. This is an important piece of property. This is a significant project. And therefore, we did look very closely with the help of our consultants, with the help of input we received from the community in developing that scope. Obviously, we want to continue to work with all parties in an expeditious way, and we will do that. But I encourage all parties as well to make sure that you take the time necessary to read these documents, and to make sure that submissions do reflect the wide amounts of data and the alternatives that the town board is going to be looking for in the scope, ultimately, of a draft environmental impact statement. Just so again, I think it's important to continue to talk about the process. We will be taking action tonight on a scope, and I think it's important that everybody knows why, is that because if we did not take action tonight on a scope, the developer would have the right to say, our scope is going to be the scope of the draft environmental impact statement. We believe this scope reflects input from you, from my colleagues, and from town staff and our town consultant, and that it's important that all of that material be considered in the review of this project. But once that scope has been acted upon, it again is the responsibility of the developer, as Mr. Danielli indicated, to submit a draft environmental impact statement. The board and our consultants and staff will look at that draft environmental impact statement, and we will do so and get a recommendation, not only from ourselves, but from staff and our consultant, as to whether it is complete and ready for public review. And we'll be looking at whether the issues identified in the scope as important are considered as a decision is made as to whether the draft environmental impact statement that is completed is submitted is in fact complete and ready for public review. So that was I know it's complicated, seeker is complicated, but I want to try to explain where the next steps are in this process. But more than anything else, I want to convey to all of you and those of you that are watching at home, we had probably 200 people here or close to it at our last meeting, and I'm sure a number of you are watching at home, that your comments were important to us, that we listened to them, and that as we go through the scope, much of what we heard is reflected in the significant changes that are in the scope that we're going to take action on. Chris, you wanted to say something?
Yeah, Bill, and thank you. When a citizen tells me that I'm not listening, I'm troubled. I'm troubled to the point of insult, frankly. This is a process. Because I can listen to two sides of an issue does not mean I've accepted either. I've been asked, I've been charged, I've been elected to make a determination here. I avoid this area of town at all costs, if I can, because the traffic is horrendous over there. Am I not sensitive to that? I live in Brighton, I know that. It's very difficult, but at the same time, the developer has indicated to me, you know what, we heard those same concerns when people were considering the car wash. So I said, you know, maybe I can be wrong, but my job is to listen. Because I had this discussion with a friend of mine at a card game last week. He says, it's impossible for that development. It can't be possible. Why are you even bothering considering it? Because my job is to listen. I said, I don't announce my decision first and then listen. I listen first, and I listen to all alternatives. Also, this project, like all projects, presents an opportunity. Perhaps it could make the corner better, but not at the expense of destroying it. So I'm going to listen. Then I'm going to consider and discuss. Then I'm going to decide. But we're still at the listening phase. All we're doing now is saying to the developer, and to you folks too, who I think haven't read the scoping document, that this is what I want to hear about. As part of the listening process, these items have to be considered, and to suggest that these comments that you folks have made and spent a lot of time providing to us are being only considered as a footnote, then why at pages 7 and 8 are these alternatives required to be discussed? Alternatives based on access scenarios at Clover Street and Allen's Creek. Access scenarios shall include no access, partial access, and it goes on. Also an alternative, what would the project look like if it had complied with existing zoning? Please, we've spent hours working on this document. I've spent hours of my own, out of my own time at the law practice, which, because I've been charged with this responsibility, that I give this first priority, to get this scoping document complete, as complete, based upon what you folks have told me, And they have, and those comments have been incorporated in here. I'm listening, and I believe I speak for my colleagues. We're all listening, but because we can listen to both sides doesn't mean we accept either. First, listen. We're going to see an environmental impact statement, which has got to be, based upon this scope, extraordinarily comprehensive. I want to see that this is a good project, positive for the town, and positive for that intersection. That's all I can do to assure you that I'm listening to everything here, and I constantly hear that a decision has been made, a soft decision. Some sort of decision has been made because the developer is advertising for tenants. I haven't made a decision, and I'm a long way from it. Please, I know you don't intend to insult me. Perhaps you don't know me, and perhaps it's my training as a lawyer that I can listen. I'm always amazed when a judge can sit there and listen to my adversary talk about things that are obviously not true, but the judge will listen and then hopefully rule in my favor, is all I can say. Folks, I'm listening, please. Thanks.
I think it might help.
Jim, thanks, Chris. I do want to just, because we are in the open forum portion of the meeting, I do want to see if there is anyone else here that would like to address the board during the open forum on this or on any other matter, whether or not it's a matter that's on our agenda this evening. I do want to give people that are here the opportunity, if they're planning on staying for the whole meeting, to hear the various action items that the town board is going to be acting on tonight. But Jim, if you have something you'd like to say.
I'm the only guy up here that's not a lawyer. So, anyway, I think it might help.
Councilwoman Novaros, who could not be here tonight because of a family matter, is also not a lawyer.
I think helpful to the public if we just touch base on the process by which we are required to go through, just as Chris was just iterating here. Whether or not that's Ramsey, our town planner, or Ken, our town attorney to the town, this is just the beginning of this whole process. We're only at the very, very beginning of this. So no one's rushing to a judgment here. And just as Chris said, we're here to listen right now. We're listen and mentally masticate everything that you're saying to us, as well as the facts and findings, not only from the applicant, but also from Stantec, who we have hired to help us review this whole process. So with that, I just say, Ken, anything we want to add for the process so people really understand the steps that we're going through right now?
Yeah.
A lot of people are so frightened.
I think the supervisor covered it briefly before, I don't want to spend a lot of the open forum time reiterating what has already been said. Honestly, I think you all understand. I think our residents are pretty with it, pretty on the ball, and I think. You understand that we're going through an analytical process. Would it be easier for everyone if this project would just go away? Probably, but it's not. And so the town board has a legal obligation to consider it. And those legal obligations stem from New York State law. And New York State law has a very set process that we are following. And that's the way that you want your town government to function. You want your town government to take serious consideration of action of such a large magnitude in our town. We are all Brighton Town residents, me included. I go through that intersection constantly. I live right off of Clover and Monroe. And I can tell you that this town board is the type of town board that you want, because they're going to consider all of the issues that you've raised. They're going to listen to all of the issues that you raised. That's why you've got an 18-page scope that the developer is going to be required to respond to. 18 pages of concerns that the town board has about the project. 18 pages of concerns that reflect your comments about what this project might mean in your neighborhood, in your town, in our neighborhood, in our town. And that's what the process requires of the town board, is to consider the project, consider the alternatives. If you take a look at the scope that has been outlined, alternative number one is development of the site under the density limits permitted under the existing zoning designations. It's exactly what you're asking us to consider. And so the town board is going to consider that. The sponsor is going to be required to analyze that. And this town board is not going to approve a environmental impact statement that doesn't address each and every one of those issues that you've raised, that they've raised, that staff has raised, and that's the process. And we go through a serious process to consider serious and important projects like this, so that the decision that is ultimately made is one that the town board can have confidence in, and you can have confidence in as residents.
Thanks, Ken. I do want to ask one more time before we go on with the rest of the business agenda tonight. Is there anyone else that would like to address the town board on this or any other matter during our open forum?
I would just like to add, because the supervisor has spoken, my colleagues on the town board and the town attorney has spoken. I also want to add that this is the homework assignment. So the scoping document identifies each of these areas. The developer can't have it back on our desk on Monday morning. This is going to take some time in order to develop and prepare and present to us. And then at that point in time, then we have our homework cut out for us. And it's our obligation then to review the information and listen to the public. And I vow to you that I have been listening, I did listen, and I will be listening in the future, because we want this to be a good project, because if this is a bad decision and a bad project, then we're the ones that are stuck with it. And none of us want that, including myself.
Going once. Is there anyone else that would like to address us in the open forum? Then we'll proceed with the agenda. And the next item that we have not already acted on is to receive and file communications. We have one a piece of correspondence from Dr. Ann Kress, the president of MCC. Can I have a motion to receive and file that letter?
So moved.
Second.
And that letter relates to my attendance at the MCC's annual observance of 9/11 at their truly striking 9/11 memorial on the MCC campus, which was one of the first 9/11 memorials constructed following that terrible day, and the work that the student body did in making it happen, and that the administration then in place and currently in place has done to continue that observance every year is important. So we have a motion to receive and file that. Dan, please call the roll.
Councilmember Vogel.
Aye.
Councilmember DiPanzio.
Aye.
Councilmember Werner.
Aye.
Supervisor Mealy.
Aye. Committee reports. The Parks and Recreation and Community Services Committee, Councilmember Novros, who is the chair, is not here. That committee will next be meeting next Monday. That's September 28th. At 4:30 p.m. at the Brighton Recreation Center at Brookside School, 220 Idlewood Lane, although some ways easier to get to off of Winton Road. Finance, Chris.
Bill, Finance met last Tuesday, September 15th. The matters on tonight's agenda were also discussed at length in the Finance Committee. Other than there was a discussion about the independent accountants a report on agreed upon procedures performed by the auditors, Raymond F. Wager, CPA's firm, of the police property room inventory. I know there have been some concerns in other areas of the community, of the county, with some criticisms about how the property room was handled. There are matters of value, there are evidentiary matters or items in the property room, cash, drugs, all sorts of things that really have to be kept close tabs on. And we were very pleased that Mr. Wager's office came in, did sampling, did determination that everything's being handled in accordance with proper procedures, made some relatively minor suggestions of changes. And Mark, do you have any comments on you want to add to that? Or
I don't. It was a pretty thorough review, and it just showed that we adhered to the best practices and the recommendations that were made, we are going to accept and adopt.
In addition, there was a discussion of the possibility of engaging the services of a third-party vendor to manage and provide crash reports. Mark, maybe you can explain that as well. But,
this is an organization in the digital age. The term convenience factor, when people are involved in a motor vehicle accident, there's a request 100% of the time to obtain the police report. There's a couple ways you can do it. A lot of the insurance companies do it through the mail, and there's a process. A third-party vendor can take this information, not have to put staff time, and they'll sell the information to insurance companies. The town, the police department can benefit. There's a per report fee that would be attached. It's called a convenience fee. If a resident's involved in an accident and wants to come into the doors, currently we charge 25 cents a copy for an accident report. In our new process, we will give those reports to residents that want to come in and get them. If an insurance company does not want to do that, does not want to send an agent in, they will purchase it through this company called APRIS, getcrashreports.com, and then it's a win-win. It's a company that is starting to gain a foothold in New York State. We would be the first in Monroe County. They represent agencies large and small, large sheriff's offices, large cities across the state. I was pretty impressed by the company, shared it with you, and it looks like, and Ken reviewed the contracts, it looked like it was a win for us, so.
We haven't yet adapted it, but it looks like something is worthwhile considering.
We actually believe we're moving forward. It's, in conversations with the supervisor, I've been in contact with the company. We've signed an administrative agreement. We're trying to work on some IT issues, and then once that occurs, and I anticipate within the next week or so, we will be live with it.
Good. But the next meeting, but otherwise, the other items discussed are on tonight's agenda. Next meeting will be October 6th at 3:30 in the stage conference room, and everyone's invited to attend.
Thank you, Chris. Public safety, Jason.
Yes, Bill, the Public Safety Committee has not met since our last town board meeting. Our next regularly scheduled meeting will be on Tuesday, October 13th. We meet at 8 o'clock in the morning in the lower level community meeting room, and the public is invited to attend.
Thank you, Jim. Public Works
has not met since our last town council meeting. Our next scheduled Public Works Committee meeting will be on Tuesday morning at 9 a.m. on the 6th of October in the lower level community meeting room. And again, as we say again and again, these are all open meetings for the public.
Thank you. We have no old business, new business. The first item, reading and approval of the claims. Chris?
Bill, tonight I've reviewed claims totaling $726,498.46. Those that caught my eye, the significant ones were the Brighton High School pool rental payment was made for some $39,000. Medical premiums of about $235,000 are to be paid. Electrical charges paid in a consortium with Monroe County, some $41,000. Asphalt, still a big item in terms of outstanding invoices. This one to be paid of about $35,000, $36,000. And sewer bond payment of about $39,000 was also paid. But I believe I find the claims I reviewed to be in order, and I move that they be approved for payment.
Second.
Discussion? Dan, please call the roll.
Councilmember Vogel?
Aye.
Councilmember DeFonzio?
Aye.
Councilmember Werner?
Aye.
Supervisor Maley?
Aye. The next matter is the scope of the draft environmental impact statement associated with the zone incentive zoning application for the project known as Palazzo Plaza. You have a resolution, and I would note if you're looking at the agenda, there is a very lengthy set of communications that were received during the public comment period that ended September 11th, and as part of this resolution, all of those items of communication, most of which were submitted by email, are being received and filed. Can I have a motion, please? But I would ask that in that motion, that you specify that it does include the two changes that the town attorney and I discussed, changing the word completed in the second to last line on page 7 to prepared, and that there was a reference, Ken, to a further traffic study.
Yes, that would appear on page 8 of the scope, below the list of streets which are set forth in bullets. The sentence should now read, the following items shall also be addressed in a further traffic study. And for the board's information, town planner Ramsey Boehner has provided a Word version of the draft, of the final scope to me, and I have already made those modifications. Perfect. And upon adoption, we'll be able to forward that to the town clerk so he has the final scope. If there are further revisions made during this discussion we're about to have, we can make those on the fly as well.
Thank you. Then can I have a motion to take action on the resolution which would approve the scope as modified?
So moved.
Second.
Discussion.
Bill, again, we've spent an incredible, not incredible, we spent a considerable, a substantial amount of time expanding the scope of this very important environmental impact statement. These are items that we feel, I feel strongly, we have incorporated all of the community's concerns as best we can. One has to itemize, and that's always difficult when it comes to putting pen to paper. But all of the concerns of the community, it is going to be a big job for the developer to respond to this, and we'll see what the response is, and then we'll begin the analysis and the discussion.
Thank you. I just
wanted to add to share with the board that in addition to, I know the review that each of you made and the suggestions that you submitted, that during the public hearing, I took detailed notes of each speaker and the comments that they made. I provided those to Mr. Boehner. Mr. Boehner has made a substantial effort, I think a complete effort, to incorporate all of those questions and all of those comments from the public hearing made by the neighbors, made by the attorney for the Neighborhood Association, and into the scope so that all of those issues were covered, from big issues like develop it according to your own rules of density, although I think he would have included that anyway, to little things like make sure that you consider the impact on the Harley and Allendale school buses, which I believe one of the speakers raised, and we included that in the scope as well. So details from large to small, I think it's an excellent final scope, one that is going to be, frankly, a challenge for the developer to fully comply with, but a fair one, a fair challenge, and I think an appropriate challenge given the scope of the project.
Thanks, Ken. Any further discussion from the board? Hearing none, we have a motion and a second. Dan, please call the roll.
Councilmember Vogel?
Aye.
Councilmember DeFazio?
Aye.
Councilmember Werner?
Aye.
Supervisor Mailey?
Aye. And I do look forward to the next step in this process, and will await the development of a draft environmental impact statement to be submitted to the town by the developer. The next item, and again, thank you to everybody. I can't say this enough. Thank you to council for both sides. Thank you to all of the neighbors. Thank you to the developer. For your submissions, your comments, your information, as we've been through this stage of the process. The next item is to adjust wage rates to reflect the change in the state minimum wage requirement as of December 31st. Jim?
In the matter to increase the wage rates for all seasonal employees, for the New York State minimum wage requirement, effective December 31st, 2015, I move on the resolution as prepared by the attorney to the town.
Second.
And just to clarify a little bit, not all of our seasonal employees are minimum wage employees. In fact, most of them are not. But they are, we have a salary schedule that is updated each year as part of the budget development process. Normally that wage schedule takes effect on January 1st. However, the state minimum wage changes take effect each year on December 31st. So it's important that we update these schedules on December 31st. And the schedule has been structured in such a way that although most of the positions are not minimum wage, we've established increments between these different positions above the minimum wage, and we have maintained again this year as we increase the base salaries to reflect the minimum wage, the other salaries to reflect the same incremental increases over that minimum wage to reflect the different skill sets that are required for those seasonal positions. So we have a motion and a second on that. Any further discussion from the board? This was considered in the Finance Committee. Hearing none, Dan, please call the roll.
Councilmember Vogel?
Aye.
Councilmember DePonzio?
Aye.
Councilmember Werner?
Aye.
Supervisor Mealy?
Aye. Jason?
Next matter, Bill, seeks approval to accept donations from various corporate and community sponsors totaling $4,600 in support of the 2015 July 4th celebration. I move we adopt the resolution as prepared by the attorney to the town.
Second.
Thank you. And our thanks to all of those groups that did make contributions to us to help make this year's 4th of July the best ever. And thank you.
And Bill, can we read them out here?
Go ahead.
Credit. Wegmans, Harvey Nussbaum, Cornerstone Kitchens, Paris Kerwin Associates, J.P. Morgan Chase, Canadawe National Bank, ESL Federal Credit Union, Stantec, and Seeger and Shortino Law Firm. We very much appreciate their support of that event. It's a great community and countywide event, for that matter, and it's a signature event for Brighton.
Yes, it is. Thanks, Chris, and thanks to all of those groups. We have a motion and a second to accept those donations. Further discussion? Dan, please call the roll.
Councilmember Vogel?
Aye.
Councilmember DePonzio?
Aye.
Councilmember Werner?
Aye.
Supervisor Mealy?
Aye. And in a related matter, we have an action to amend the town budget to reflect additional expenditures incurred for the 4th of July. Chris?
Bill, this is to approve to amend the 2015 celebration budget by $3,975 to offset the additional expenditures incurred for the July 4th, 2015 celebration event. I move that we adopt the resolution as prepared by the attorney for the town.
Second.
Discussion? Please call the roll.
Councilmember Vogel?
Aye.
Councilmember DePonzio?
Aye.
Councilmember Werner?
Aye.
Supervisor Mealy?
Aye. And Jim?
Yeah, the next item is to approve appropriation of $4,500 from the general fund balance account into the 2015 tree program account to support funding needed for the emerald ash borer prevention treatment for 60 ash trees along the Brickyard Trail, which you had mentioned earlier, Bill. I move on the resolution as prepared by the attorney to the town.
Second. Bill, this is one of those things that when I saw Andrew's, it reminded us again that we have 485 acres of parkland, and we see it financed the burden of maintaining it. Now, I'm very excited about this project across the street here and the ability to now ride my bike down that trail through a woodland or just take a stroll, but then realize that, my God, there's 60 ash trees in there that are threatened. And if we're going to maintain those for the benefit and the enjoyment of the public, we're going to have to save them, and there's another $4,500. Yep. Yep. Where are we going to get that from? I always say all the time, but somehow we've been able to do it and stay within the tax cap. But we've got an obligation now that we've got these up to almost 500 acres in parkland. That's a lot of land, and it costs money to maintain it. So
it does, Chris, and you know, in general, we're not treating every ash tree in every one of those 500 acres, because it really wouldn't be practical, and because the liability risks are different in many of those areas, which are, many of them are passive, not intended to, you know, they're not improved by trails or picnic areas or anything else. When we went through this area, I went through the area with town staff and our representatives from landscape architects that helped lay this out. We saw this stand of ash trees, and in that woodlot area along Elmwood Avenue, there are a lot of trees that are sometimes derisively called weed trees. They're fairly significant in size, but they're very quick growing. But these ash trees are different, and ash trees, as we've talked about in the past, the emerald ash borer is a real threat to Brighton and to Monroe County. We have the highest percentage of ash trees in Monroe County of any county, not just in New York State, but I believe anywhere in the country, that is currently had the emerald ash borer identified. It would cost us probably as much to take these trees down, which we would have to seriously consider because they are in close proximity to the trail, than it would to just treat them and continue to have the benefit, because these are definitely not weed trees. These are good, strong trees of different ages, and you know, we can't guarantee this treatment is going to save them all, but what we can say with almost 100% certainty is that if we do not treat them, they will die within the next few years, and with that, another little piece of our tree canopy. And I know that's not acceptable to me, and I don't think that's acceptable to any of us. And we will spend some money to do that, and we will continue to have that asset. We have a motion and a second. Anything further? Dan, please call the roll.
Councilmember Vogel?
Aye.
Councilmember DePonzio?
Aye.
Councilmember Werner?
Aye.
Supervisor Mealy?
Aye. Matters of the supervisor, I've already talked about a number of things, the budget, the fire open house, but I do want to mention this week, September 22nd through September 29th, has been declared by Governor Cuomo as Climate Week in New York State. And the town of Brighton is a climate smart community, which is a New York State program. There are only three climate smart communities in Monroe County: the city of Rochester, the town of Brighton, and the town of Irondequoit. As climate smart communities, that gives us access to resources through the state's DEC to help us become a more sustainable community. One of the things we did before even becoming a climate smart community was to establish the Sustainability Oversight Committee that we've alluded to tonight. You saw tonight in approving the purchase of a Vactor for a leaf vacuum system for leaf removal. That's a recommendation that they made that the board consider as a way not only to pick up the leaves more quickly, but to do so in a more sustainable way. We've been facing budget challenges and tax cap challenges for many years, but we did feel this year that it was worth putting into the tentative budget. We're fortunate to have on our staff dedicated professionals like our town engineer Mike Guyon, our planner Ramsey Boehner, to my right Tim Keefe, our commissioner of public works, all of whom, and others, all of whom have taken a key role in the development of our sustainability policies, our role as a climate smart community. The Monroe Avenue Green Infrastructure Project, which is funded by state grant funding, which will not only protect stormwater but have many other benefits, including encouraging pedestrian traffic along Monroe Avenue, which of course improves the sustainability as a community. By the way, our health as a community as well. But maybe the most important thing that we can do is to plan ahead, and that's what we're doing through our comprehensive plan update. That also is funded through one of the really sustainability programs of the state, the Cleaner Greener Communities program of NYSERDA. And that program, that comprehensive plan, will take a look at Brighton's future. It will be our roadmap for the future,
and that future will be a more sustainable future. And so we will continue to celebrate Climate Week this week, but Climate Week in Brighton is going to extend a lot longer than 1 week. We're going to make it a 52-week of the year experience because we do believe that each of us, government, individuals, businesses, all can make a difference in making sure that we are a more sustainable community and prevent further climate change. So I wanted to note that. If anyone in the community would like to reach out and get involved in our Climate Smart community activities, please feel free to do so. We'd like to have you. I also want to turn it over to Chris Werner.
Thanks.
Because Chris is really the has spearheaded another great project here in the town.
That's spearheaded, but I certainly participated, Bill, and I hope folks have already noticed. I've gotten some feedback already. I know, Bill, you have too. But if you go by the fire hall tonight, you'll see a change out front. That traffic control box has got some beautiful Dalmatians on a red field painted on it, and also another box has been decorated at Winton and Westfall as well with great designs. But what's exciting for me is not just going through those intersections and seeing something better than some graffiti, call it graffiti, but someone defaced the box, but now we've got these beautiful decorated boxes, is the community process, how this is a community project. This began with Rochelle Bell on the Sustainability Oversight Committee. And under the category of new business, she said, I don't know if this is sustainability, but those traffic control boxes ought to be painted at 12 corners. And I said, Rochelle, I don't care if it's sustainability or not. I'm with you on this. Let's get together and talk about how we're going to do it. We educated ourselves on the process for petitioning the owner of the box. Well, first Tim told me how, you know, we don't own those boxes, that they're owned by the state or the county. And I've learned how to identify which is a county box and which is a state box. Anytime you see yellow housed traffic lights, those are county boxes. The traffic control box is county owned. If you see a green housing around a traffic light, that's a state highway. And the state owns those. And the problem is the state doesn't generally allow decoration. I'm trying to work on that, see if we can get some movement, maybe at least for 12 corners. But the county does allow it. You've seen them all over the city and other towns as well. But from Rochelle and I, we said, well, who's going to paint them? And we were talking about forming committees, and I put a bug in the principal's ear at one of our meetings, one of our breakfast meetings. And he then talked to the one of the teachers in the art department, and we got an inquiry from Deborah Berger, who was the advisor to the Brighton High School Art Club, and said, gee, they'd be interested in decorating those traffic boxes, and it's, let's go. And Rochelle and I agreed that, yeah, we can spend a lot of time developing a large committee and go through a whole process, or maybe we could just get a couple of boxes painted. But then the issue came up about, well, who's gonna paint them? Well, the kids are going to be great about it, and they've really developed some terrific designs. And they juried the designs and came up with a top one, and then we asked for a second, so the second one as well, these two designs are. And but then it came down to something concrete like, all right, how do you do it? First, you have to prime it. All right, who's going to prime it, and who's going to buy the primer? And Tim said, I'll prime. It was the Tim and Chris primer show that went out, and we primed the boxes together. It was a small undertaking, really, but a lot of fun. And then the kids went out just yesterday to paint them, and it was great to see them transfer the designs from a small image like this to a large-scale paper cutout, and then sketching around it, and then they painted and got them all done in one day. And then the question is, well, who's going to put the anti-graffiti paint on? Tim said he was busy today, so it was just myself. It took all of an hour, but went out with some real heavy-duty anti-graffiti paint and put on it. But you look at him, you go, you know what? All the different parts of the community, and there's a lot of other things that can be done around town. So, you know, to paraphrase one of my heroes, is, you know, ask what you can do for Brighton. Don't tell me what's wrong with Brighton. Tell me how you're going to fix it. And Rochelle said, let's fix it. And from there, with the help of Tim and the school and the community in general, we can get a lot of stuff done, real concrete things done just like that. It's a small thing, you know, those two boxes, but gives me a smile every time I go through those intersections. So thanks to everybody.
Thank you, Chris. Thank you, Rochelle, to the students. It was fun watching them work yesterday. Chris and I went out and watched them painting both of the boxes, and they did great work. And but really, Chris, you did great work. I posted pictures on my Facebook page today. I got a couple of suggestions from residents on other potential boxes. And it has been our plan to, you know, solicit more designs.
Yep.
And we're not going to, you're absolutely right. You know, we don't need a big committee to do this. You know, I have a lot of confidence you'll get out there and continue to work with our schools. And some of these aren't in the Brighton School District. We might get ideas from some of the other schools near some of these other locations. But they do make a difference, and thank you for that.
Great.
That's all I have. Matters of the attorney to the town?
I have none this evening.
Thank you. Matters of the clerk?
Nothing, just a reminder of speaking of schools, you know, the school tax collection in full going, and October 1st before our next meeting, so fulls are due, so we'll be open, 9 to 6, Monday to Thursday, until 5 on Fridays, and keep an eye out for the reserve parking signs on those last days to make sure that, trying to make it so you can get in and out as easy as possible.
Thank you, Dan. Matters of the board.
Reminder here about the pharmaceutical recycling.
Thank you, Jim.
This Saturday,
the pharmaceutical take back, which has been a tremendously popular program, thanks to the police department. The DEC regulations require the police to be involved. Some of these drugs are, opiates. So officer or investigator Tim Karch has been a part of this program for a number of years. One of Tim's other hats that he wears is advisor to our police explorer post, and those great kids are out working on that project. You'll see them again out this Saturday, but from 10 to 2 right here on the public safety side of town hall. It's a drive-through. If you have the materials right in your car, in the passenger area, you don't have to get out of your car. But we will take liquids, we will take sharps, prescription, non-prescription. Everything is taken to a secure incineration facility and incinerated. It keeps, Louise would have the tonnage, and it is tonnage, that we have kept out of the waste stream, out of the water stream. Don't flush them down the toilet, please. Bring your old medications. We talk about prescription take back sometimes, but they don't have to be prescription drugs. You know, if you got a Bengay or whatever, you bought it over the counter, bring it in. It's past its expiration date, you don't need any more, bring it in. Don't let, you know, we've unfortunately, and the chief can, you know, unfortunately talk about this at length. We have seen medicine cabinets become targets of misuse of drugs that in some cases are very addictive, very dangerous drugs. Make sure your medicine cabinet doesn't have those drugs that you're not using. Bring them in. We will incinerate them. We will take them out of the waste stream, and we will make sure that they don't get misused. So thank you, Louise Novros, for all your work over the years in making that project happen. Thanks for reminding us, Jim, and we look forward to seeing you Saturday starting at 10 to 2. Thank you to our staff here, our cable TV team that brought the meeting to you tonight, whether you watched it on your computer streaming or on channel 12. Can I have now a motion to go into executive session to discuss the employment of particular people?
So moved.
Second.
Dan, please call the roll.
Councilmember Vogel?
Aye.
Councilmember DePonzio?
Aye.
Councilmember Werner?
Aye.
Supervisor Mailey?
Aye. We won't be coming back out into open session, so I want to thank everybody that was here tonight. We'll see you at our next meeting, October 14th, right here at 7 p.m. Have a great evening.